so if members will take their seats, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Thanks to all the Deep Rec members who got here early at 5:30 to do, a tour of Scott Cave, which is a little bit too strong for giving us an in-depth tour, is to understand the different kinds of classrooms and classroom needs that your students need. So I will say I've learned a lot. I mean, it just shows another example of the complexity of the buildings we're working with, and that if DREC is going to be true to its values on equity of access to programs, support, electives, and supports, that buildings are your real constraint. And so it's how do we balance all of that going forward. So I think, at least for me, this was a real honest reality check. So thank you for letting us walk through the building for the past hour and kind of learn what's happened in the last couple of years since you took the principalship here. So thank you. All right, so we'll go ahead and get started. So for agenda tonight, so we have two main substantive items tonight. So one is we're going to get informational overview and update from different program directors in the form of, you've got one pager handouts in your folders, but then we have the programmatic staff here. So what we'll do is once that presentation starts, we'll do back and forth Q&A. And then after that, we'll have a brief equity check-in, which will help set us up for our broader conversation tonight. So the other thing that Cam and I did want to acknowledge too is this is kind of our last actual, second to last information gathering session. And so this will begin our process to pivot from information gathering to, laying the groundwork for our deliberation stage of figuring out, given all the pieces that we've learned, how do we start putting it together in the context of meaningful guidance that will help both the programmatic staff and the staff in system planning and performance to develop scenarios going forward. So just think going forward, that's how the first substantive hour discussion is going to be. It's warming us up for the bigger conversation. So what we'll hopefully email out in the next couple days is how both Pamela and I see that arc moving from this to those discussions going forward. So with that, I'm going to ask Janet, do we have anyone sign up for public comment?
Yeah.
We do.
Cheers.
Here we go. We have two folks, Nicole first. Well, I just wanted, I've been walking the building with most people who are here, but as a member of the Scott PTA and as someone who has been in this building for 4 years on and off, I just wanted to thank you guys for actually coming and seeing the building. And I think what you probably saw is that we have a lot of wraparound services and we have a lot of moving parts, and it takes an incredibly talented administrator to make that work, and two has been awesome. Like, this is a totally different school than you would have walked into 3 years ago, and so I want you to know that she's making it work, and it doesn't always work this smoothly. So that's like the kind of something I think we should also keep in the back of our minds. So clearly we need a lot more space than what our numbers show that we need. And so 500 seems to be about our sweet spot in this particular building. But we also get really nervous. There was a scenario floated that had us sitting around 400, and we would not have the FTE for anything extra. And we already struggle with that because so many of our kids have to have certain hours of special ed and ESL and things like that. And so this is a real big challenge for us, is to find that sweet spot, and we hope that you'll be able to do that. And then I guess I just want to make two other points. This is that there are many other schools like us, right? So this is us, this is where we are, but if you go over to Lee, you're gonna see even a smaller building with very similar issues, right? And so we really have to try and find that sweet spot for all of them. And I would suggest prioritizing the sweet spots for the Title I schools first. And then finally, especially in light of today's announcements, TUHU is committed to making this work and is making this work, but we desperately, this community started engaging 4 years ago for this process, and they have fallen off. We had 110 people in our cafeteria putting dots on charts 4 years ago, and they're not here anymore because they're tired of the process and they want the change already. And so while there are some things that have changed a little bit or improved or not, the bottom line is we need that process. We need to move to our K-5. We need to get on to the next level, because we've had three, four, five cohorts now go through our middle school where we're like putting little things in little holes to try and make it work. And so those are the things that I hope you take away from today's visit this month. I really do appreciate you coming out.
Thank you.
And April?
Hi. I wasn't necessarily planning on talking, but since I'm here, I wanted to share. My name is April Woodfull, and I'm a parent here at Scott. I have a first grader, and next year we'll have a kindergartner here. And my family, we're very committed to the neighborhood, so we have great pride in Roseway Heights. We've been very happy with our experience here. I'm lucky to have come on board with Scott at the same time that our new principal did, so I don't have the experience that some of the families have. I have great confidence in Madison. I was able to go to one of their, I can't remember what you guys call it, but the planning symposium type thing for the new building and meet with the principal. And so I have great pride in Madison. My number one concern with where we're at is middle school. So I know I have a ways, but by listening to how long the process has gone, I tell myself, I don't have to worry about this because I have a first grader. But when I listen to other parents, I think maybe I do need to worry about this because maybe that's not long enough for the districts to find the answer or the solution. I've worked in middle schools in the past, and I firmly believe that a K-8 model cannot prepare students for high school. High school today asks a lot of students, and I just don't feel like a K-8 model like this has the resources needed. I don't think it can differentiate the way it needs to. I don't think it can offer high school courses the way that it needs to. TAG students should have options to take courses at higher levels, and I don't think that the K-8 can do that. I think with Madison Heights nearby, we have an excellent solution. It's a building that was a middle school. I think the resources for having a middle school that close to a high school are fabulous. Not a lot of districts have that opportunity where we have kids that can literally walk and access different courses as they need. So for me, the biggest piece is just waiting to find out what is the plan for middle school. How long do I wait to invest in my home and things like that and make it a forever home until I know what that looks like. And then one other piece that I still sometimes struggle with is the commitment to Spanish immersion. So it's extremely important to me. When I learned, we moved here well before Scott became an immersion. When it became an immersion, I thought, my dream come true. My neighborhood school and a Spanish immersion, both things I firmly believe in. And I've been lucky, but it's kind of sad to say lucky. I've been lucky in the fact that in 2 years, I've been able to have my child in a classroom with a steady native Spanish-speaking teacher. But it shouldn't be luck. It shouldn't be that the other families in my school have students that are splitting 50-50 or students that constantly have subs in and out and don't have the ability to have Spanish-speaking subs. So it's a little disappointing that I signed a contract to commit to Spanish immersion, but sometimes I worry that the district didn't commit. So thank you.
Thank you.
Okay,
Jenna.
Really quick, I want to exercise the chair's prerogative and just grant 2 minutes because a lot of us did the tour. I just want to open up the floor really quick. Was there any kind of one particular standout aha moment or an observation you heard or saw going on the tour with a lot of us in two this evening? Grace?
Speaking as an educator that does small group work as a reading specialist, trying to get my head around how they're going to have 5 certified teachers doing small group work in the same room. For kids, a lot of the kids that I work with need to have I'm in between two noisy kindergarten classes right now in the closet, and it's distracting, so about how to manage that is just blowing my mind. How to support the kids that need that quieter space and that small group instruction, because it's going to be kind of a lot of things going, a lot of transitions, and look at the word. So.
I've got one for you, which was when we started this process around recommending to move from a K-8 to a middle school model, it was based on the observation that students who were in middle schools had more access to elective offerings. And so one of the things that we'd identified and heard from community testimony, actually about Scott specifically, that was when we started, the only offerings at the time were, and Nicole, correct me if I'm wrong, but office assistant and cafeteria helper?
Yeah. There was maybe choir and PE, but those were the other two, yes, to make it work.
So when two walked us through
You've got art, STEM engineering, music, art and mariachi, technology, leadership, and choir. So for me, just to see kind of an evolution over, you know, a 2-year period since we started this process and DBREC calling out the reason why the shift was important, I think is pretty phenomenal to me. And so it's this acknowledgement that, you know, we have systemic problems, we have processes that are moving not as fast as we would like, but that doesn't mean, you know, communities are finding ways to respond until we actually make some big changes. So I'm just to hear the change in 2 years for me was just awesome. Anyone else?
I'll just both Zach and Abraham pointed out that building leadership was a huge factor in all this.
Thank you for letting me exercise that 2 minutes. I'm going to turn it over to Laura, who will facilitate the group discussion.
Thank you. For those who don't know me, I'm Laura Parker. I'm the Senior Director for System Planning and Performance, and I am your substitute today, as Judy Brennan, of course, normally facilitates, but had to be out today for medical reasons. Don't worry, she was emailing rapidly by like 11 a.m., so I think she's all right. Tonight, we're really excited to feature program leaders representing a number of the diverse offerings that Portland Public Schools offers to its students. We did provide one-page, or in some cases two-page, overviews in your packets for each of the programs. A couple of folks couldn't be here tonight, but you do have information about their programs as well, so you can look for that. ESL and Early Childhood will be here. Oh, thank you. Wonderful. Let's get you a chair. I didn't even see you come in. So we have about 45 minutes, and I'm going to let each of the representatives talk for about 4 minutes or so, give an overview of their program. I know that the committee is particularly interested in how we've thought about expansion plans of the programs in more recent years and, of course, moving forward. And, of course, what role equity has played as we thought about services to our kids throughout PBS. So I know that the program leaders will represent those voices as well. We'll let them talk for about 4 minutes, and then we'll do a Q&A open to the members. All right, sound like a plan? All right. Thank you. I'm going to, because I already told her that I was going to make her go first, I'm going to have Debbie Armendariz, who's our dual language immersion program director, open up.
All right. So, yes, I've been introduced. I do apologize for being late. My husband had surgery today, I think, for a pretty good reason. And it was delayed in 4 hours, so it was hard to get here. But to share a little bit with you about dual language immersion, we currently have 15 programs, looking at having 16 by fall across 5 languages in about 25 schools. We also support native language literacy in a few languages, including Somali. If you look at our website, or if you Google PPS and dual language, our website comes up, and you can read the findings of the research that was funded by the RAND Corporation. How many of you have that as background knowledge already? I'm wondering. Okay. So that research showed that the outcomes for students in our programs at Portland Public match the outcomes that have been generated by countless other research on the power of dual language instruction, particularly for students who are English language learners. The research on our program showed that students who were English language learners and participated in a dual language immersion program that matched their native language exited ESL services at much higher rates than those that were in programs that were English-only programs. And that's really significant because the best predictor of whether an ESL student will graduate from high school is if they are able to come out of ESL services before it's time for them to graduate. So you're going to read all about those outcomes, including the fact that by the time they are in eighth grade, they're at least a year ahead in English language arts, as measured by state outcomes. So that those findings reaffirm what we have known for many years, since around the 70s, that actually more time in English does not generate better results in English. More time in the native language and more time in a bilingual study will get you better outcomes in English language arts, as well as math. So that's a little bit about our programs and the instructional impact of them. They are considered part of focus options programs, and they're in very, very much in high demand. We have each year about 230 incoming kindergartners that are not able to access our programs, that lottery into them and are not able to access them. We are currently coming very close to meeting the demand of native speakers, not so much in Chinese, but in the other languages we are coming very close, but transportation continues to be a big barrier for native speakers to access those programs. The last year and in previous years, we shared a lot of information with this group, with the people who were in this committee, around our priorities, the impact of dual language on student outcomes, and the impact of co-located programs, the challenges that school buildings face when they have co-located programs. And that means that there's an immersion program in a school and there's an English-only program in a school as well. So that is the setting where almost all of our programs live. Only the Richmond Japanese program is not co-located. All of our other programs are co-located. And we did identify three big priorities for the coming years. The first one is to identify a permanent location for our Vietnamese immersion program. It has been at Roseway Heights temporarily for a few years, and it has hurt, that temporary status has hurt our ability to entice students, native speakers of Vietnamese as well as native English speakers, to come into the program. So permanently siting that program is our top priority as a department. We also have identified through the expansion committee that Chinese and Spanish continue to be languages where we have native speakers that are not able to access those programs. We are starting a Chinese program at Harrison Park next year with the kindergarten and the first grade class. We're super excited about that. Enrollment is almost full for that program, kindergarten first. And we hope that that will take care of some of the demand from the Chinese community. As we look at our outcomes, one of the things we measure as a department is whether we are increasing the number of English language learners in the district that we capture into immersion programs. And we are every year that our department has been a department, which we're in year five. This is year four for me. We've increased the percentage capture of English language learners into immersion programs. We've increased the percentage of historically underserved students into immersion programs, the percentage of students on free and reduced lunch, and there were two more. Historically underserved students of color in the immersion program, particularly in kindergarten. And while we have increased the number of Chinese students, that is the one place where the percentage of native Chinese speakers that are accessing immersion programs has actually gone down. That is because the number of Chinese speakers that are coming into our district at kindergarten is increasing at a rate that's higher than our ability to meet their needs. So that is the language group with the, we'll say, migration into our district that is the highest, and it's outpacing our ability to support them. And then the last priority, which you have written on your sheet, is around addressing the challenges of co-located programs. One of the ways that we are doing that next year, there are actually several ways we'll do it, but the one that I'll highlight is that next year will be a transition year. We'll be planning to identify ways that regular could turn into an immersion-only school in a way that would not impact Scott. Please stop the myth that that would have an impact on Scott. Scott would continue to be a co-located program, but Riegler would shift into being an immersion-only program and thus be able to add one strand of immersion to that program. So that's
where we are. Was that 4 or 5 minutes?
That's perfect.
Okay.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I'd now like to introduce Mary Pearson, who leads the Special Education Department Programming for PS.
Good evening, you guys. Thanks for having me here. So Special Education and PPS, we serve students with disabilities that meet the state requirements for special education services. We are, as a district, we are right now at about 7,100 students that qualify for special education student services, and we're at about between 14 and 15%. We provide special ed services in every PPS building, PPS approved charter, community-based option, and multiple pathway programs. That services tends to look like a learning specialist, and then we have itinerant staff like speech language pathologists, school psychologists, and motor staff that provide services to our students. The majority of our students are served in their neighborhood school, and those services come to them. They spend the majority of their day in general education classrooms with a variety of different services that's defined by their IEP, their individual education plan. Also within PPS, we have some special programs. So for students who graduate from high school with anything less than a standard diploma and qualify for special education services, they're eligible to receive educational transition services up to the age that they turn 22, so through 21. So we have a community transition program that has multiple campuses and provides services in the community, on college campuses, at PCC and at Portland State. It's a pretty robust program there. We also have focus programs throughout the school in the K-8 at the K-8 levels. K-5s and K-8s in middle schools, and those we have focus programs that meet the needs of students who have very particular and pretty more intense needs, either around academics or social and emotional, and those are they're called our intensive skills classrooms. Those serve a variety of students, ranging from students that are medically fragile to students that experience an intellectual disability and need a lot of academic support. We also have social-emotional skills classrooms that really provide services and extra support to students that are experiencing a lot of challenges around social and emotional regulation or need mental health services. In addition to that, we have a special school. It's called our Pioneer Special Schools, and that is a K-12 program. And that meets the needs of our students that have the most significant social and emotional and mental health needs. And they really do need a separate school to receive pretty intensive therapy and services. With our K-12, with our high school Pioneer program, we have both therapeutic classrooms that are in comprehensive high schools as well as on a separate campus. So looking for future considerations, some of the things that we're looking at next year. Every year we work with our Multnomah Early Childhood Program to transition students into kindergarten who have a disability and will have an IEP in kindergarten. And we have anywhere from 450 to 500 students that come into kindergarten every year that have an IEP. So every year we look at the needs of those students and determine what we need to do with our programming to meet the needs of those students. And for the fall, we are realizing we need to open a couple of new focus classrooms. We have our communication behavior classrooms. They support students who have maybe behavior challenges that are due to a significant communication, social communication delay. An example of that might be a student who's on the autism spectrum and need a lot of support around a communication system to help them navigate their environment. So we're opening two new K-2 classrooms. One will be at Widmere, where there already is one classroom there, so we'll have a K-5 continuum at Widmere. And the other will be at Boyce Elliott, where we also have one classroom already, so we'll be building a K-5 continuum there. The other is just looking ahead to the planning of the middle schools. And one of the nice things about a middle school model for special education is it does, when anytime you have larger programming with more students, it allows for more programming. So like our comprehensive high schools, we have a full continuum of supports in our comprehensive high schools so that students can, most students, can attend their neighborhood high school and receive and benefit from that full continuum of support. So what we would really like to plan for in middle schools is that we would build what we call comprehensive middle schools as far as special education services. So we would have some of these focus programs within the middle school. For example, you would have learning center supports. You might also have an intensive skills classroom and a social emotional skills classroom in right in the program. And so that allows more students to attend their neighborhood school to have their IEP services met. And then if we do still have K-8s in the district, those students at the 6-8 level, if they needed that level of support, they would just go to their comprehensive middle school. That's all driven by their IEP.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you. Unfortunately, Karina Wolf couldn't be here tonight, so thank you, Lorna Fast Buffalo Horse, for stepping in from Full Alliance, as many of you all know, presenting multiple pathways.
All right, I will do my best. Karina Wolf is the director of Multiple Pathways to Graduation, and you see there's a number of different programs that are encompassed in that department, so I'll do my best to kind of give you a broad overview. The multiple pathways percentage of the district is about 20%. So about 1 in 5 PPS students is a member of one of these programs, or sometimes more than one. So that could be a student who just moved to the district and needs to find another school and is getting support from the intervention services. If they have a gap and they can't get straight into a school, they can be served by the Reconnection Center, which is located with Alliance at Benson. We have part of a wing at Benson High School in between manufacturing spaces, large rooms where classrooms have been kind of cobbled together, sometimes without floor-to-ceiling walls. It's a very sparse space, and that's where our Alliance at Benson students and staff work. I know that tonight people were commenting on staff rooms and libraries. None of that stuff exists there. But there are up to 200 students a year served in that program. There are also community-based organizations, schools, so 11 schools operated by nonprofits in Portland that serve students and are working towards a GED or high school diploma. That is a contract with PCC for high school completion and GED. There's also other schools operated by NAIA, by POAC, there's the Helen's View School is an option. There's several that are operating around the city, so there are 11 of those. DART schools, our day and residential treatment schools. These are for students who have mental health needs that are very great. Students may be served in a setting like the Perry Center, and Portland Public Schools through DART pushes teachers in to work with that agency so that students are getting their educational needs met along with their mental health needs. The handout says Youth Authority and Juvenile Justice. I think that some of that is more future planning. Right now, it's the MESD, not Portland Public Schools, that operates the school at Donald E. Long, or what most people refer to as Judy. And then Portland Evening and Summer Scholars is part of Multiple Pathways. That program helps students recover credits for classes that they may not have passed in any of the high schools, any of the CBO schools, Alliance. Those programs have a great impact on our district grad rate, because it is helping students to graduate either within their four-year cohort or impacting the district's five-year completion rate. So that's a huge program that many, many students access. Learning and Credit Options is similar. That offers other supports to help boost students closer to graduation. So that might be virtual scholars class that are offered in about, I think, 20 different buildings in Portland Public. Credit by exam. So in my school, we have 3 students this week go from Alliance at Meek over to Cleveland High School. These are 3 native Spanish-speaking students. They went to take an exam in Spanish so that they could meet the high school graduation rate, because they're native speakers, instead of doing 2 years of courses, which are not really at their level. So that's another way that it's another one of those multiple paths to graduation. And then charter schools are kind of the exception in Multiple Pathways, because many of the students served by charter schools are K-5. There is also this year, I believe is the last year for the SEI Middle School, which is a charter school, and then Trillium is a K-12 school. But at this time, most of those students are K-5 students. The rest of Multiple Pathways is primarily focused on high school graduation. And then we have a social work coordinator also, who is a professor at TSU in the School of Social Work and brings interns into the schools because there's, as you can imagine, there's never enough budget to pay for the services that our students need. Multiple Pathways students are overrepresented in all of the subgroups by the district in terms of poverty, in terms of students of color, in terms of male students, in terms of overage students, in terms of the mobility index, in terms of special education. The only exception is English language learners are underrepresented in Multiple Pathways. But every other population, Title 10, which is our homeless students, my school is 19% of students who qualify for Title 10 who are meeting the standard for homelessness. So there's a huge need for social workers. We've had 3 interns in my school at Meek this year and 2 interns at Alliance at Benson, and it's very, very helpful for us. So that's a little bit about Multiple Pathways. We will be seeing the Ed Options report. I know it's on the work plan for the spring. Anybody remember when that's going to be discussed here in DBRAC? We've seen it. And I think it's in a meeting, 1 or 2 meetings from now. And so that Educational Options report also details a lot of the facility considerations specifically for Alliance. For example, we hope that the bond passes. I guess I can say that. So the people will vote on a bond, and if the bond passes, Benson High School is one of the schools that will get redesigned, and that will change the, that will be a potential eviction for Alliance of Benson. Reconnection services DART. And so where are those students going to be served? The population's increasing in Portland. The needs of these students continue to be high, and the needs are not currently met in the regular educational system.
Thank you, Warner. Really appreciate you stepping in tonight. And Andrew Johnson, who leads our talented and gifted programs.
Hi. So to give you a broad perspective of talented and gifted education, currently we have about 6,200 students across 80 schools. That makes up about 14% of the population. We are, at this time, an inclusive model, meaning that we don't have an institutionalized pull-out program. We did many years ago, but at this time, we don't. So what that, what the implication of that is that we have to meet student needs at their neighborhood schools. So we've been working quite diligently to strengthen those neighborhood programs as best as we can. And some of the ways that we do that is from meeting with staff, meeting with principals, working with teachers and teams to talk about how do we meet students' grade level, what does depth and complexity look like, and generally intellectualizing the curriculum in such a way that students can really access the curriculum from whichever entry point they need to access that. And then we do have an Access Academy, which is an alternative education program. That school is for students that have scored at the 99th percentile on a nationally normed referenced assessment, and they also need to show an alternative or an educational need for an alternative program. And so right now that is co-located at Rosie with Beverly Cleary, which is pretty close to our office, which makes that great because we can offer any kind of support to David Wood, the principal, or to the students at that particular school. So in terms of programming, like I said, we're really just focused in on the neighborhood schools as best as we can, and just strengthening that program. I think that we've made quite a bit of traction over the past 2 years. We have a lot of work to continue moving in that direction, specifically around our historically underserved. PPS has struggled with that for many years, and I think we're moving in the right direction, but we have a lot of improvement still to go, and I'm looking forward to next year in terms of us considering some various and perhaps even outside of the box ways of bringing in our historically underserved students. It's socially and politically complex, specifically talented and gifted in our community, but we believe that it's very important to work with the community in a positive partnership in order to continue to move to work forward and to find ways for us to be able to continue to meet our students. Student population to serve them well. I think in terms of future considerations, we're also looking at how to strengthen the partnerships that we already have. So some of our partners right now are OMSI, Saturday Academy, PCC, Virtual Scholars, and I just met with Reed College this past week as well, because they have a Young Scholars program themselves that they have actually partnered with PPS for many years, but I've been interested in strengthening that partnership and looking for additional opportunities with the rich resources that we have in PPS. You know, when I meet with folks, I learn something really fairly consistently, I would say almost monthly, in terms of what resources we have. So really tapping into those resources, I think, is very, very important for talented and gifted. Because of that inclusive model, it is challenging. And students. Teaching is very complex and it's exhausting, and it's one of the most difficult professions, I think, in the world. And providing that level of support to our teachers is absolutely critical. Whether that's through professional development or in these partnerships, and bringing those resources to schools is very, very important. We have been working on a new endeavor that's called the Scholars Program, which basically is about creating a more deliberate and intentional framework in a school. So basically what I do is I go in and I meet with the leadership team, and we talk about through their building tag plan or through their history, how have they been meeting student needs and what would they like to do? Sometimes they don't have enrichment, for example, after school or before school. So those resources in our community are really critical because I bring those to the table, right? So sometimes if a school, maybe they haven't had access to Saturday Academy or OMSI or some other partnership, then we link those partnerships to the school to provide additional resources for students. Our goal really, yes, we need to consider how to meet the students that have been identified as talented and gifted. And they are typically identified in three areas: intellectual, reading, and math. But our goal really is to use those high operational practices and strategies to elevate every child. And I think that that's in a new direction, perhaps, than what we've done in the past. And we're excited about that particular work because we recognize that many of those best practices that yes, we can use to meet students' rate and level for talented and gifted are many of those same best practices that we can use to support our Tier 1, Tier 2, or our Tier 3 students. I think that continuing to move forward, that's a step, again, in the right direction. So going back to the Scholars Program, then we evaluate and kind of do a needs analysis of the school, determine what kind of resources the school needs, and specifically what we've really focused in on is professional development. Last year and this year, meeting with teachers, so that we can impact more deliberately and more concretely what happens in the classroom. Our parent community really desires to see things that are more concrete and more predictable. And that's what we've really been working on, is determining what are those best practices that we know can meet the needs of talented and gifted, and how do we help teachers be able to access those best practices so that they can meet student needs in the classroom. So that kind of gives you a broad, I think, view of where we are at this time.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And Clarissa Hightower, right? I appreciate that. I'm going to let you introduce your role with ESL. Thanks for coming.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Clarissa Hightower. I am one of the assistant directors of the ESL department. I say one of the three of us. I support our middle and high schools. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about our program. Qualify for the ESL program via a test. And when you register your student in another language other than English is listed on the registration form, it flags the system and we send a testing specialist out to the school to give the student a test to see if they qualify for the ESL services. You exit the ESL services via a test as well, and that test is given every year around spring. Instructional models that are present in schools once students have qualified for ESL services come in two basic forms. We have our push-in model, where students are not taken out of class to provide them with their language support, but rather that support is provided within the classroom that they are currently in. That can be via co-teaching, where there are two teachers teaching the students at the head. There can be smaller groups going on, and the students rotate through those teachers. But the idea behind that is that the language support can be provided for students in the environment that they are already thriving in their current classroom environment. The other model is pull out, and depending upon how many students you have at your school, ESL students you have at your school, that might be a model you use where the student is taken out of the classroom and provided their language support in another classroom. The state in general is moving away from the pull-out model and towards a more inclusive practice of providing the language support for students while they are in class. That looks very different based upon grade. Our 6th through 12th graders have a standalone class because that's how the scheduling goes in 6th through 8th grade. However, we are working across departments to support content area teachers so that they can provide language support for their students throughout the day, so that they're not just receiving that one dose when they see their ESL teacher. About 2 years ago, the state of Oregon had a big shift, and we noticed that our students who were exiting the ESL program were not showing the progress or the success that we like on the state assessment. So it was Oaks 2 years ago, and now it's SBAC. But there was no alignment. So we would have students who would exit our program who were supposed to be proficient in English, but then not doing very well on their state assessments. And so the state got together with some other, with a consortium that included 8 other states. And they revamped the test, but then also created 10 new English language proficiency standards that align more closely with the Common Core state standards, so that there wasn't such a gap in between what we were asking of students. We went through 2 years of making sure that not only our ESL teachers were equipped with the knowledge they needed and the support they needed to move forward with these new standards, but we also informed our content area teachers that the rigor, if you will, was going to be more prevalent in the standards with our ESL teachers, and that we should see an increase or a match for our students who exit and who can perform and succeed on the ESL. It's important. We also have a standalone program for what we call our newcomer students. Newcomers are students who have been in the country less than 2 years. This program currently is for high school students only. It is actually based in Benson as well, so Benson has a lot of programs working out of that building. The cap is 35 students, and the support that is provided is very specific to newcomer needs because they have 0 English. The future of the program, we have been working really hard to make sure that we collaborate across departments so that, because our students are only with their ESL teacher for a short period of time. What we want to make sure is that our students are getting the support they need throughout the day. So in order to do that, we collaborate across departments so that information that is disseminated to our ESL teachers is also shared with our content area teachers, and they feel that they have someone who can support them if they have a lesson, if they are teaching. They can ask their fellow ESL teacher, well, what scaffold can I add to my lesson in order to make sure that my ESL student has access to this information. So eventually, we like to build their capacity so that they don't necessarily have to go to their ESL teacher. That ESL teacher is always there as the expert. We are also, we have parent meetings about our House Bill 3499. How many of you have heard that phrase? I know you have.
I know you do.
It's our meeting. So the state of Oregon classified Portland Public Schools as a targeted district as far as their ESL students go. And basically, targeted is the second to lowest category in how our ESL students are progressing. And they categorize all of the districts, and we fell into targeted. And what that measured was the progress of our students in their language development their success on math and ELA and their graduation rate of our ESOL students. So in those areas, it showed that we needed some growth in those areas. And so we met with the state and shared our plan of action with them. But before we did that, we collected information from the people who it affects. So we have parent meetings to make sure that we ask the parents how we can better support them as well as their students. We also spoke with teachers and other members of the district to ask for their input before our plan was submitted to the state. Once we submit our plan to the state, we will have 3 years. In total, we get 4 years to bring ourselves out of targeted status. And the plan that we put together and we put forth should be that is the goal. Once the plan is submitted and we have it approved, that is something that will be public knowledge and we will share. And we will have meetings to discuss what the plan is and how we can be a part of that.
Great. Thank you all. I really appreciate it. We have a little more buffer on some of the other agenda topics, so I assume we can open up to questions. I want to make sure everybody gets one.
Pamela, I did a poll, and I think what we wanted to try and do is to try to hold 10-minute blocks so that members got a chance to do a Q&A. And so two things that I would ask for us. One is acknowledging, like, this is not the first time that we'll, you know, get to hear from directors as questions come up. You know, Pamela and I can work to figure out if there's a clear question that we need additional information. We can ask, you know, guidance memos or have them do an additional presentation. So this is not like the one chance to ask them a question. But also because there are a lot of program directors here, I want to make sure that everyone gets a chance to ask a question that's like the most fundamental burning question that you got before, you know, we ask them. So I just want to try and preserve that. Okay. So, Donna?
I have one question. A lot of what we talked about is safe here. And we've got Olivia to tell us about the plan, but is there anything in the plan that you think might have implications for space needs?
No.
Rooms, small groups.
So the instructional model is different at each school, right? And so if your school currently has a classroom, nothing that we put in our plan would necessarily affect that.
Okay.
Grace? Mary, quick question about on the CFB or the Rosewood Heights, if there were the theories in terms of supposed to be with the moving the 6-8 intensive skills room from Beverly Clear to Rosewood Heights. And I'm curious why that move is happening.
Well, in order to create a full continuum in buildings, we want to do it budget neutral as much as possible. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what's happening with that third grade. I think it's staying at K-8. A lot of our other middle schools already have at least one or three special programs in their buildings. So we would try to, whenever possible, if there's program that serves kind of that geographical area, we would move that into the middle school. So there are two of the same programs at Beaumont, for example. So we have two programs in the same cluster. Actually, we have three of the same classrooms in that cluster. So we want to move one to the next cluster.
And the other question was, does Vestal also have a social emotional program currently?
No, Vestal has two intensive skills classrooms. And they're the K-5 level.
And so would those be moved to Rosewood as well?
No, because they would be, if Rosewood Heights becomes the middle school,
yeah. There
already is a 6-8, there's already a 6-8 social emotional classroom at Rosewood Heights right now. So we would just need to add the intensive skills classroom to create a full continuum.
So Vestal, you said they don't have social emotional classroom.
They have two intensive skills classrooms, a K-2 and a 3-5. So they would stay.
So they don't even have that.
Yeah. Yeah, there, it's on the back of my, where all the programs are.
On the back of my.
There is, I saw one mistake, though. There is two social emotional classrooms currently at Roseway Heights, a 3-5 and a 6-7. So ideally that, I don't know what will happen with the 3-5 at this point.
Anyone else?
Yeah, Kim.
I heard that folks that have, that are native speakers that are seeking immersion language programming are having difficulty getting transportation. I'm wondering what PPS is doing about that.
We have some limited transportation at some of our programs. So there's a lot of limiting factors for how much transportation we're able to provide, and interestingly, one of the limiting factors is our ability to find bus drivers. It's been a challenge. I don't want to start naming which programs have them because I'm bound to lose it to not mention one of them. But what we do at our programs that attract and where we recruit students from outside the neighborhood, at most of those, we are able to provide usually one bus, and that bus then usually stops by the schools that those children would have been going to, and then takes them to the immersion school. But it is a limiting factor because anytime you adjust transportation from what someone is going to have at their neighborhood school, it just changes the whole dynamic. Sometimes if families have a school that they can walk through that's their neighborhood school and it doesn't provide an immersion program, that might be more convenient than a bus ride for them, depending upon work and all kinds of complexities that tend to go along with the lives of native speakers. So that's the whole thing about it, but that's the limiting factor is really around our ability to find bus drivers and then our ability to pay for the transportation.
Anyone else have our first question?
TESA serves about 30 students.
35.
What's the, and they're really cramped. I saw it was on the work plan for them to move/expand. So what's the actual need versus what we actually serve?
Oh, so our need for newcomers is definite. So in general, TESA is a voluntary program. We cannot require students to go to TESA. The need for a newcomer school that will accommodate more than 35 students is great, but space is a commodity. And so we do have plans for potentially providing newcomer strands, if you will, inside of existing high schools. That's a possibility. But our focus now, since we know that space is an issue, is to provide the teachers who are already seeing the kids with the support they need to be able to better support their newcomers, as well as bilingual EAs who would speak the language of the students in the other.
Okay, but if space wasn't constrained, and you had multiple sites, how many kids would be in a piece of, like, program?
For the summer? In high school, so a high school
piece of
program?
Yeah. We're talking 100 or we're talking just ballpark?
150.
Anyone else for a first question?
I don't need to answer the question right now, but I think one of the things that we think about is the projected size for access, and I know that that will significantly impact this whole area and how we think about location. And I don't know if you're ready to address that now, but as we sort of move towards the deliberation stage, I know there's been a proposal in this, and just researching for us to understand what that timeline looks like, or how we can use whatever information available, because it's a big piece of the North Northern puzzle and the
Yeah, have anything else to add to that at this time. You're right, it is a complex issue, and it's something that we're going to have to figure out at some point.
But there's not like a timeline or collaboration?
Not that I'm aware of.
Any other questions?
Any other first one? We can't have one or two questions more, and then move on. Johanna, I can hear you. Kurt, did you want to?
Can I ask a question? I was going to ask. Those not many.
Anyone else?
The scholars program, which schools have that in our children?
Just really through relationships with principals. That's how it's called. Because we need buy-in at the school level. So right now, Ainsworth, Forest Park, the level. Bridger to some extent.
Questions, if you send them to both Pamela and I, and we'll forward them on to Judy and staff, and we can get additional responses. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
All right. So as we transition to the next half of our agenda, I wanted to take a moment, and similar to some of our previous meetings recently, have an equity check-in. We've got the compass on your tables. So if you could just take a moment reflecting on the information that you've heard, some of the thoughts going through your mind, and look at yourself on the compass and maybe turn to a partner and take a minute to share.
I'm not sure.
like an internal system.
Stay this year.
Well, and again, super important. You know what I mean?
So that didn't get, I thought that didn't, there had been some, it just, that was never
resolved. No, they, I don't know if it was, can I ask if there's anything I need to do for this before the No, I just need to have,
I'm sorry.
Every time one table's ready, the other two aren't. So I apologize. We've got not quite an hour to do some committee work, and you all are already there, so keep your thoughts fresh. Thought we'd take about 25 minutes to go through some discussion questions in your groups, and then about 15 minutes or so for a report out and general conclusions. And the co-chairs drafted some prompts to help facilitate your discussions. You're already all there, and reflecting on the information that you received. So thinking about what do I wonder about the information, discussing how the information from this week impacts your cluster focus areas, and then reflecting again on the DBRAC values framework. How is equity impacted? How is access to programs impacted? How is the learning environment impacted? So again, about 25 minutes for those discussions.
That's cool. People are in their cluster groups, so some people aren't, so you are not with the cluster group that you're supposedly focusing on. We invite you to stand up.
This is your moment to get a breeze going across the room.
We got a bunch of them.
Oh, yeah. So we have some.
Thank you.
looked at things. I mean, I think that the detail that the facility wasn't presented, I mean, not that it wasn't presented, but it was in the handouts, and they were kind of high or positive raises. So the first part is, what do I want to know? And then as we
access not wanting to have a special education class.
So the cluster work is definitely, I think, on the 40 I also think one of the next meeting is all about stories. So you don't want to forget about it. And
so
do value
the information
the story side, which is walking around the building and talking to students and parents and trying to bring back to but we ultimately have to get to a place to then, so we recommend, I'm just going to take a recommendation from our last one. Next meeting.
So can I ask a question? So the question, the recommendations that we're coming up with, or the questions that we're coming up with,
so like that's what you say,
what should happen?
That's why. Trying to think about the work that
where's the grant this year? But they don't, they're not in a, right, there's no path. But we could use it. Do they have any special coffee? Okay, so let's pull it in just to show. Okay, so it's just
those issues.
Well, I mean, it's kind of like
So
So that way, so.
So we know.
In a regular.
Total of this.
Sure.
So ultimately, so in case of George.
Yeah.
Right.
And there are 30. So that, in terms of that classroom mechanic.
You know, I don't know this by much. It's okay because I can make a recommendation and
with windows and so when I'm looking at this is for this. What I'm looking at is. For the next school year, with the stuff that everybody has
graduated,
what I'm thinking is, what I would love to see, is an updated kind of system for 2017 school year. So like, here's my additional cheat sheet, so when someone tells me, like, oh, I use map table for
So what I want to understand is how many of these are in the chart, you know,
but that's good. I mean, that's what I'm saying.
That kind of master's
like, I want to, that's what I want to understand. So we say,
that specifically, it can't be a reference.
They're not accounted for here, right?
Yes.
So
there's so many
hospitals.
It's supposed to be the population is per student. And then there's like four or five masters.
Because we can't do that for students.
Right? because we think of middle school there.
I just meant
clarify questions.
When I was 39 and there were people at
5%
more robust. Period. So that's what I saw.
Laura,
I understand that you use the amount I'm sure it doesn't.
Is there a more robust version of this that's more detailed than just total number of classrooms?
Because now
Like, that's literally how it played out.
The Beverly Cleary
kids.
They're in this kind of special ed. So I was just kind of.
Anyway, we now hear or staff him to all the rooms this summer and coordinate with what the rooms will be used for this school year. So thank you, but that was last year.
Because like in any given year there might be
so there's a lot of like interpolation of
that's
in terms of
the
data.
That between environment and program, because it's like it's almost like there's like some sort of environment and program, and it's so
that is
one of the triggers that leads us to
going down on.
So maybe
I'll
use the term audit because I can't put it better. That it's just leveraging
professors
from other approaches.
I'm thinking about if we were going to say,
So that's one question. Everything's being based on
two strings.
One or two highlights of what they discussed, just so that we can remain as a group, seeing where different tables are.
Great.
That would just be helpful for
Agreed.
Jason,
do you guys want to start?
Yeah, I'll start. I'm happy to start because if we don't, then I'll probably forget what we're going to talk about. So one of the areas that we looked at was special education. So for the classrooms located in the Roosevelt cluster. And so one of the things we started looking at were the classrooms that were located at both James, John, and Sitton. So Sitton having, you know, two classrooms set aside for intensive skill centers, and then one at James, John, you have 1, 3, 5 for social emotional skill centers. So you've got those two programs eventually converging at George. So for George, you've got 3 classrooms set aside. So for us, it came for a couple of things. One was also living in North Portland myself. One being that's 3 classrooms set aside. So wondering at that local level, we have two different, at least two different kinds of special education programs there.
how does that middle school program, could it apply there, and how do you actually work with ensuring that the special education students are effectively accessing the same core content and electives, given we've got multiple special education programs located on site? And then the one learning that we started to identify was, so the chart that we also got at the meeting or two meetings ago around the middle school space comparison. So the one thing we kind of recognized was, in looking at the special ed classroom camps, there's no explicit line that says, minimum classroom set aside specifically for special education. So our wondering was, where's that number kind of, is it embedded in the regular classroom camp? So given the metrics that we have, how do we try to account for those numbers in different programs in the next stretch?
We were copying. No, we talked a lot about how do all the metrics mesh. What is the impact of how do we get good data, and how does this chart tie with other data pieces? I think our group also identified three or four main wonderings. So one was just how many strands are we doing. Second was the Ed Options Review Committee update. That was worth reading. We actually have an update from that. We'd like moving forward. Some more detail around inventory of common spaces in schools. So really understanding the materia categorium. And I think I need to be more clear on this, but the capacity of each school, I think that's a problem for how many rooms are not used for purposes that are not gen ed, education, and then how many rooms are set aside for special K-5 or elective in 6-8, and then how many are set aside for. So really understanding on a little more granular level, so that we don't unintentionally create overcrowding. So those are sort of our wonderings.
Yeah. Other piece was high school.
And the other piece.
Yeah.
And that Lorna brought up. Because
there's no high schools on this list of special classrooms. So do students' intensive disability needs disappear in high school?
Amen.
Or do they end up in alternative schools because there are no intensive services in the comprehensive high schools?
I thought she said that all of the high schools had a full program.
That's a question for clarification.
There was definitely some discussion, and we will check for that specifically in the minutes.
Thank you.
That I was so diligently taking that
can't
find the
exact
center. Can I add really quick? In addition, so I think building off of like the more data, like different classroom counts, the ask that we identified was a more robust version of the dot chart that has those different categories, like gyms, primary, secondary, classrooms over 500 or 800 square feet, ones that are under so we can account accordingly. Rooms that are used, that can be used for community partner space, one-on-one group. So having more robust so that we have a common playbook for how we're counting rooms that are not just for core and electives, but supports and community spaces, because we have some data, but also a lot of community members know their own buildings better. So it's how are we, hopefully this fall, using the same data set or are more close to accurate?
Really getting the principals just to
what are these
rooms used for.
Send
us a map and tell us what
the rooms are. And Sarah said these maps are actually not exactly all accurate. They need a little note at the bottom.
Little asterisks.
Updated, last updated.
Yeah, last updated 1932.
I want to make sure that this group has something here.
We had the same question about high schools, not in terms of where the spec was, but how to include the high schools in this whole discussion. And some basic things like what is the decision about access going to be made?
Yeah.
Are we making? We heard from Charlie that there was a report that Andrew gave saying the minimum should be 500, 500 to 550 at access. And directed that was the teaching and learning committee, and they directed the staff to get potential sites. So I don't know if Andrew just didn't understand the question that was asked. But, okay, yeah, so. And then also, I wish I had asked Debbie what the recommendations, what are the current thinkings in the DLI department for where the Vietnamese program should be placed. Because that's their number one goal.
The
other two things I think we mentioned very briefly were with all these adoption expansion and DLI expansions, what are those effects going to be on the neighborhood schools?
Yep.
And how does that, like, can we be strategic about trying to pull some students out of schools that are overcrowded? Not just. And then the other one is for DLI co-located programs, how can, or do we have any power to try and help them integrate the DLI program with the neighborhood programs more so that they're not two separate schools occupying the same building, fighting for resources?
So I think one thing that came up at our table, and this might be a good way to close out our meeting, is we had a lot of discussion about how are we applying this learning and how do we make this transition to get from here to recommendations. So I've heard that at the first table, I've heard that here. I'm sure it was over here. And so I think the action item for Jason and myself is to start off next presentation with sharing what that looks like. So that was our goal. We didn't quite get to have that completed for this meeting, but I ask that you live with that ambiguity for 1 week, and we will try to address that really clearly, and we'll leave some time for questions when we convene it.
And the other thing is, I think our next meeting is at Tubman. So we'll be able to get a facilities tour of that as well prior to our show.
With some commentary from
Nisha
about the dance recital that she had. So, and before we adjourn, anything else?
The one other thing we talked about in sort of trying to figure out what our scope of recommendations were, whether we should be trying to come up with sort of recommendations about triggers for, like, if a school is at 100%, that means that this process should happen. Or if this school is at this much differential from the SES average across the district, that triggers, like, if that's where we should be rather than these sort of micro moving students between schools.
So that's a perfect point because
perfection. Hey.
Awesome, because we recognized that we had a big chart where we said, like, current state, aspirational state, and what are the levers. What Pamela and I realized, I think last week, was we have all of these levers, but in order for us to move forward, we needed to build a fundamental committee meeting where we are sorting through which levers do we believe we have actual influence on or not, and in what capacity. So the bulk of the meeting next week is a combination of understanding how do we, cultivate and identify stories as part of our learning and applying that to our work. But then the other part of it is doing that explicit exercise. And that'll frame how we go forward because what I think some of us veterans have recognized is that when we're in community engagement mode, everyone appeals to DREC for everything. And we want to be able to be very clear about with the community on the onset where we have influence and where we don't. So when communities are testifying, they know they're clearly testifying us knowing that we have the ability to influence versus those who don't. So that's, Johanna hit it. She knows exactly where we're going. So, it was a lot of info.
What time? Tour start at 5:30?
Yeah.
All right.
Is soft neighborhood model on the agenda next time?
No.
No, it's pushed to the first of June.
Yeah, so then remember, the 1st of June will then be that longer meeting.
Yes, yes.
Hopefully you can all attend from 4 to 8. Okay.
Membership, thank you so much.
Adjourned.
Is that when I back at PPS?
No.